Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. Myself Komal Yadav, research scholar of Galgotia's University, attached with CFSL CBI New Delhi. In today's module, we are discussing about antemortem and postmortem injuries, burns, scalds and electrolysis. At the end of the module, you must be learn about the various medico-legal aspects associated with burns, scalds and elocution injuries and the nature of different type of injuries and the most important assessing the antemortem and postmortem injuries. Now, first of all, introduction. The distinction between antemortem and postmortem injuries are probably one of the most prime problem faced by the forensic medicine experts and the official who seek answer to the time of injury sustained by the victim. The correct interpretation not only help the conviction of the guilty but also the acquittal of the innocent. Hence, it is important for the forensic medicine expert to make detailed observation, which should ideally include the following points. Internal appearance of the injuries. It is the naked eye appearance of the injuries. Historical timing of the injuries. It is based on the morphology of various stages of wound healing. Histochemical timing of the injuries. It involves the study of enzymes such as adenosine triphosphate, aminopeptidase, acid phosphatase and alkaline phosphatase in the wound region. Biochemical timing of the injuries. It is the measurement of histamine and serotonin content of the injured skin as compared to the intact skin of the same individual. Difference between antemortem and postmortem injuries. What are the differences between antemortem and postmortem injuries? The salient distinguished features of antemortem and postmortem injuries are as follows. On the basis of characteristic feature of hemorrhage, in case of antemortem injuries, it is profuse and arterial. In case of postmortem injuries, it is slight and venous. In case of antemortem injuries, clotting of blood occurs. Blood clot when it is laminated. Blood clot firmly adhere to endothelium lining, but in case of antemortem injuries, clotting of blood is absent. Blood clot if found non-laminated and clot weakly adheres to the endothelium lining. In antemortem injuries, due to deep infiltration of the edges of the wound are attained which cannot be washed away. But in postmortem injuries, no infiltration and hence the edge are not stained and strains if present can be washed away. Next, on the basis of the feature of wound edges, in case of antemortem injuries, wound edges are gaping, everted and swollen, but in case of postmortem injuries, wound edges are opposed and not swollen. Third, on the basis characteristic feature of vital reactions, in case of antemortem injuries, inflammation and granulations are present, but in case of postmortem injuries, inflammation and granulation are absent. On the basis of microscopic examination, in antemortem injuries, leukocytes and RBC infiltration between muscle fibers and clot composed of fibrin, RBC and platelets. In postmortem injuries, vessel distended with postmortem clot and clot composed of fibrin and RBC. Next is on the basis of enzyme histochemistry. In antemortem injuries, negative and positive vital reactions can be seen. In postmortem injuries, vital reactions are absent. Next, on the basis of serotonin and histamine biochemistry, in antemortem injuries, increase in the content of serotonin and histamine. In postmortem injuries, no increase in the serotonin and histamine contents. Next is burns. A burn is defined a traumatic injury to the skin or other organic tissue, primarily caused by thermal or other acute exposures, namely heat, cold, electricity, radiations, or chemical. Burns may be classified into three categories. These are epidermal burn. In epidermal burn, affected part is red in color. Blister formation can occur, marked, and in medicine, inflammatory response occur in the areas less damaged by burning. Singeing of hair, it is very painful. Scars of epidermal burns can repair without scars. Next is the dermoepidermal burns. In dermoepidermal burns, wall thickness of the skin can be destroyed. Formation of coagulation, necrosis of epidermis and dermis can occur, lesion have a dry, leathery appearance. Formation of scars can occur. Scars contact causing disfigurement. It creates lots of considerable pain and shock. Next is deep burns. In deep burns is completely charring. In deep burns, it creates gross destruction of subcutaneous tissue, muscles and bones. It can destroy nerve endings. Burns therefore is less painless. Next is the assessment of burn area. It is the rule of nines. The rule of nine act as a rough guide to the body surface area. It is Lund and the Browder chart. According to the age, there is a change in the size of the head, thigh and legs. Head size is 1%, hand and fingers and the fingers are closed. The estimation of burnt surface area can be worked out by the rule of 9. In adults, head is 9%, front and back. Chest is 18%, back is 18%, right arm is 9%, left arm is 9%, right leg is 18% and left leg is 18%. In child, head is 18%, front and back, back 18%, arm 9%, chest 18%, leg 13.5% and left leg is 13.5%. Wound assessment and cares, different degree of burns. Superficial burn is also known as first degree. For example, sunburn, flash flame involve only the epidermis. No topical antibiotic is needed. There is no blister formation, only edema. Erythematous dry, it is very painful due to PG protection. Healing occur within 5 to 7 days. There is no formation of scars. Partial thickness burn, it is also known as second degree. There is a destruction of all epidermis and variable thickness of dermis, and it is divided into two parts. One is superficial dermal, that is known as degree A, and deep dermal degree 2B. Superficial dermal degree 2A is light pink in color. It is wet. It is very painful with blister formation. Healing will occur within 7 to 14 days by epithelium cell. Formation from the skin, appendages and the minimal scar formation can occur. In deep dermal degree 2B, it is very few viable of cells remains in deep dermal. It takes slow epithelialization which need months with scar formation. It is very less moist, it is very painful, it gives positive result with pinprick test. The blisters are not characteristic because thick and adhering of dead tissue layer to underlying viable dermis. Next is full thickness burn, that is known as third degree. In full thickness burn, there is destruction of entire epidermis and dermis. Will not heal. Color is waxy white or leathery brown to black. There is no blister formation. There is no pain and no sensation. In this case, hair can be pulled out easily. Next is fourth degree burn. It involves underlying structures. Same finding as third degree burn with involved bones and tendon. Next is zone of coagulation. Dead tissue, zone of ischemia status, marginal viable tissue but still viable. The vessels in this area are injured or prone to injury. Damage endothelial cell lead to mediator release or infection and further decrease in blood flow and converting this zone to non-viable tissue. For example, the burn changes from second degree to third degree. Next one is zone of hypermenia. Viable tissue responding to injury by inflammation. Severity of burn depend upon the size, site, depth, age. Increased mortality in less than 2 years of age because of the increased the surface area. Immature immune system, immature kidneys. Also increased mortality in patient over 50 years of age because of associated diseases. Associated injuries, for example, fracture, injury, head injury, internal bleeding. Next, severity of burn can be classified into few types. One is major PTB, partially thickness burn, second degree is less than 25%, FTB, third degree is less than 10%, or burn of critical area like face, hand, foot, perineum, and complex injury, inhalation injury, and other trauma treatment is in burn center. Second is moderate burn of TPSA of 15 to 20% of second degree or 3 to 10% of third degree burn, usually treated in community hospital. Third one is minor total burn is less than 15% of TPSA second degree or less than 3rd degree, usually treated in ambulatory clinic. Indication for admission. 1. PTB is less than 15% in adult, PTB is less than 10% in child, FTB is less than 10% in any age, burn in face, hand, foot, except minor cases, inhalation injuries, electrical burn, associated major medical illness, for example DM, others consideration age, home situation and level of cooperation. Next is the medico-legal significance. Due to heat, stiffening and coagulation of proteins, the body presents a pugnacious attitude. The condition is present in both dead and alive, and hence no medico-legal significance. Presence of soot in esophagus or stomach depicted that the victim was alive when the fire was progressed. Mucosa and trachea necrosed due to inhalation of hot air. Blood thickened due to hemoconcentration and cherry red in color due to carboxyhemoglobin. Suicidal burning is common. Homicidal is rare but have known to occur with criminal intent. Accidental burn can also common. Next is scalds. A scald is an injury sustained due to application of liquid at or near the boiling or from the steam. The injury is limited to the skin, mouth, throat. When hot liquid are drunk, moist heat usually cause bleaching effect and shedding of the skin. In scalds, what you will see, the skin become reddish, it swells, formation of blister can occur. The skin becomes charred. What should you do in case of scald and burns? First, running toward the cold water. Put your hand under cold water tap for at least 10 minutes. Remove any jewelry. Apply a sterile dressing or cling film. Treat the casualty for shock if necessary. Seek medical help if necessary. Next is the classification of scalds. Scald is due to moist heat, classified into three types. Erythema. In erythema, skin appears red immediately. Vesication. In vesication, formation of blister can occur. It takes place within few minutes. Next is necrosis of dermis, deep skin layer. The main source of scalds injury are spills of hot coffee or tea, spills of hot food, such as creamy soup, tipped from the stove or countertop, or while being carried, spill of foods or beverages cooked or heated in a microwave oven, hot tap water, mostly from accidents in the bath or shower team, escaping in a work environment. The main setting for scald injury are the kitchen, dining, bathing area of our home. Scalds in kitchen and dining area typically happen when a young child pull hot beverages or hot food down on themselves from table. Stoves or countertops, they can also happen when they pull on a pot handle, a tablecloth, or the cord of the countertop appliances. Next is the medico-legal significance. Scalding is usually accidental. Severe scalds of mouth and throat when hot liquid is taken orally. It is deliberate. Scalding is common in child abuse cases. Forcefully immersion is also common. Next, we are discussing about electrocution. What is electrocution? Electricity is the flow of electrons from atom to atom. Electrons which comprise the current are passed along from atom to atom. Every time 6.242 into 1015 electrons pass a given point in a second, 1 ampere of current has passed. Electronic voltage of 380 volts or less than considerable low voltage, about 380 volts. Injury by electrocution. Resistance offered by closed palm may reach 1 crore ohm centimeter per square, while the average resistance of normal skin is 5000 ohm / centimeter square. This resistance may decrease to 1000 ohm centimeter square if hands are wet. Skin resistance is encountered primarily in the stratum corneum that serves as an insulator for the body. Exposure of skin to 50 volts for 6 to 7 seconds result in blisters that have a considerably diminished resistance. Electrical burns depend on two types, low tension and high tension. Severity of electrical burns depend upon voltage, current, type of current, site, duration, moisture. Electrical burn damage by electrical flash out, that is actual contact, hotness of wires, passage of electric current, that is true electrical burn. Burn skin after healing is hypo and hyperpigmentation, susceptible for sunburns, scars, dry, itching. Next is effects of burn injury. There are few effects, local effects, regional effect, that is known as circulatory problem, or systematic effect from burning. First is local effect. What is local effect? It affects on the tissue damage, inflammation, infection. In tissue damage, heating of tissue leads to direct cell rupture or cell necrosis. At the periphery, the cells may be viable but injured. Collusion is denatured and damage to peripheral microcirculation can occur. Next is capillaries thrombosed or increased permeability, that is edematous tissues, external leakage of sucrose fluid. The difference between PTB and FTB is the depth injury. Next is inflammation. Marked and immediate inflammatory response occur in area less damaged by burning. Manifest as erythema. Mild areas of erythema resolve within a few hours. More severely damaged tissue may develop a more prolonged inflammatory response. Macrophages produce inflammatory mediators or cytokines, for example, transforming growth factor B and neutrophils, and later lymphocytes provides protection against infection. damaged tissue separates by an active cellular process described as dislogging, generally completes by 3 weeks. Next is infection. The damaged tissue presents a nidus for the infection. Burn wounds will almost inevitably be colonized by microorganisms within 24 to 48 hours, and this may remain as a local wound or regional infection. Bacteremia, Spectremia, metastatic infections. Next, regional effect problems in burn. Circulation, limb circulation may be compromised. Directly damage to main vessel is unlikely except in high tension electrical burn. Gross edema in a limb following burns, the swelling and the tissue tension may lead to venous obstruction, especially in circumferential burn tissue, ischar. Next is systematic effect. First is fluid loss. From damaged capillaries, either by visible external loss or internally into the tissue from edema in the region of burn or even of the entire body. Second is multiple organ failure. There may be progressive failure of renal or hepatic function or heart failure. The precise cause of complications is uncertain and may be due to fluid loss. Toxemia from infection or uncontrolled over the reaction of inflammatory response to sepsis. MOF may however occur without obvious systematic infection. Third is inhalation injury. Inhalation injury occur in those trapped in closed spaces, particularly common in association with burn of head and neck. Various parts of respiratory tract may be injured. Inhalation of hot gases lead to thermal burn to upper airways, manifest early by slider, cough and respiratory obstruction. Inhalation of produced of combustion cause a chemical burn to the bronchial tree and lungs, manifested by the hypoxia, acute respiratory distress syndrome and respiratory failure. It may be delayed onset. Systematic absorption of carbon monoxide CO and hydrogen cyanide from burning plastic cause poisoning. CO displaces oxygen from hemoglobin to form carboxyhemoglobin that reduces oxygen carrying capacity of blood, and it also has intracellular effect. The patient may arrive confused or unconsciousness. Next is systematic complications. Well, documented system complication in association with burns includes curling ulcer, that is gastric, leading to acute hemamastasia, immune suppression which increase the rate of septic complication, weight loss due to catabolism, response to trauma. Next is non-specific complications, which includes UTI from catheterization, DVT and pulmonary embolism. Next, we are discussing about the classification of electrical burn. First is contact burn. It caused due to close contact with a live electric object. The injury may vary from small charring depending on the length of contact. The point of entry is raised, blister containing gas or fluid. The lesion is often seen on the pads of finger or thumb. Point of exit injury look like lacerate or punctured wound. Next is spark burns. These are due to poor or intermittent contact with electrical equipment and resistance of dry skin. Yellowish parchment like scab formation is seen with a pale halo around it due to capillary contraction. These lesions may be multiple. Next is flash burn. This is due to contact with very high voltage lines, more than 1000 volts. Commonly seen in lines, men working on grid system, charring of tissues with carbonization is common. Arborescent pattern of lightning burn is seen. Crocodile skin effect. is commonly seen. Next, clinical picture of burn injuries. First is pain. Pain is immediate, acute, and intense with superficial burns. Persist until strong analgesic is administered. Acute anxiety. The patient is severely distressed at the time of injury. It is frequently to patient to run or an attempt to escape and secondary injury may result. Next is fluid loss and dehydration. If replacement is delayed or inadequate, the patient may be clinically dehydrated. Local tissue edema, superficial burn blister, deep burn, edema formation in the subcutaneous spaces, then may be marked in head and neck with severe swelling which may obstruct the airway. Limb edema may compromise the circulation. Spatial sites, burn of the eye are uncommon in house fires. The eyes may be involved in exposure injuries or chemical burns. Burn in the nose, airway, mouth and upper airway may occur in inhalation injuries. Next is coma. Burning furniture is particularly toxic and patient may suffer from carbon monoxide or cyanide poisoning. Next is the medico-legal aspects. Death by electric current is due to accidental in nature caused due to defective electric appliances or negligence in the use of equipment, and the suicide is rare. So friends, at the end of the module, you must be learn about the various medico-legal aspects associated with burns, scalds, and electrolysis injuries, the nature of different injuries, and the importance of assessing the antemortem and postmortem injuries. Thank you, friends, for watching this video. My best wishes. Thank you so much.